So welcome to this release webinar on Dynamicweb 9.2, released 2 days ago, 1 week too late. I'm sorry about that, and also sorry about the delay today. Some technical issues made us postpone by 1 hour or so. But now we're here and ready to tell you about what we made for Dynamicweb 9.2. So let's get on to it. 9.2 is the first release we made after the service release called 9.1 in October. So this is a relatively small release, but it also contains a lot of really nice features, and some of the features you're going to see in this webinar are features that we just begun to develop, and you'll see a lot more features coming in these new areas during the spring. So some of the major points of this one is the two first points in this slide. It's a deployment tool that will help you deploy settings and files from your staging and development environments to your production environments without having to manually copy paste and remember all the things going back and forward from your system. And then we have something called product content management, or PIMP, which is a new way of editing and managing products that we are starting to develop for the e-commerce platform especially. Then we have a lot of new things on the indexing engine, also used in the PIMP system. Packages, the package manager that you've seen since the 9.0 release now finally does what it should do. It has been a big challenge to get it up and running as it should, but now it's there, and we can start publish packages using this system instead of distributing using zip files. Also, this release contains a whole lot of updates to the user interface based on a lot of the feedback that we got from you and things that needed a little adjustment after the 9.0 release. And we also did a lot of things on the code quality as well. So let's first take a look at this user interface consistency. So we basically went through a lot of the screens that you reported and fixed a lot of the glitches on the UI that has been reported by you, and especially the settings section has been streamlined quite a bit. Documentation has been updated. There's a lot of new examples and API documentation as part of this release, and also we added a lot of new install guides for Azure, for example, and also for installing locally, and updated all of these guides on getting started to up and running with Dynamicweb. And then we have reworked course material for the courses T1 and T2. For now, that's also going to be available online on the documentation portal, so you can access all the course material from in there. So let's look at the e-commerce features that has been added. Indexing, which is basically not e-commerce, but it's related a lot to the e-commerce, has received a lot of new minor features that has been requested by you on the projects you are working on. So one point is the support for balancers. A balancer is when you have more than one instance of your index, and one is live and one is not live, or if you have more than two. These balancers can help you find the most relevant index available for the solution to run with. I'm going to show you in 1 minute. We also added support for partial builds. So instead of updating all of your product catalog, you now have the possibility of setting up a build action that is just updating the products that have been updated, for example, in the past hour. That's, of course, a big improvements if you just want to index a few of your products and you have a large index especially. Then we have added a contains extended operator to the index by a lot of requests, and we have a lot of new things in where you set up terms in terms of the a term selector, and we also added something called code providers. I'm going to give you a brief introduction to that as well. The user interface of the indexing has also gotten a major overhaul, so we also hope that it will help on how to use and set up the indexes. Also, Dynamicweb 9 has a new smart search, or an updated smart search for products that runs on top of the new index instead of the one that we have in Dynamicweb 8. Was running on top of the old index and has actually been deleted for Dynamicweb 9. But with 9.2 we have smart searches for products again, and now part of the PIM system as well, so, and running on top of the index with the performance and possibilities that we have on the index. And also a new thing with a field selector I'm going to show you in just 1 second when I shift to it. So let's take a look at these indexing things before carrying on. So I have the administration going to the repository sections. The first part here will look like you're used to, but this one has been quite a lot updated, so it's much easier to see what's going on and understand things going in the screens. So this one is the balancer, actually relatively simple. You have two different types of balancers. And what they do is I have two indexes, and if both of them are not updated or if both of them are not active, for example, if I'm building one of them, if I have a big index that takes maybe 10 minutes to build, it will not be online. And the balancer helps choosing the right index from, or the right instance of this index from this list. And if you have three or more indexes, and one of them is for it has not been updated, using another balancer instead of the active-passive and going to the last updated balancer will help you get the system to choose the newest available index in the solution. Then we added some new options on the build engines down here. As you can see, you can now see the settings that you have available on the on the builder itself, so you can skip different things or change the behavior. And also remember that we have a notification section on the build down here. You also got this in Dynamicweb 8.9, but you can remember to use this feature to make sure that your index is running, or you get an email if it fails to update. One of the new things that you can do up here, that is that we have a builder action called update, which can be set to how many hours do you want to look back on the product catalog and update only the products that has been updated. And this is very useful if you have a lot of updates during the day, so you can update your index every quarter or once every hour, whatever you want to do. To keep the index updated. One thing you need to do still is running one nightly rebuild of the index, at least still, because of the way Lucene handles updates in the solution. Looking at the query engine down here, so some of the new things that we have available, let's take a look at the language ID. Oh no, let's take a group ID. If I can find it, let's just take the product number. So on the right side, we have a couple of new things on the right expression. Instead of just constant and parameter and macro as we're used to, we have two new features. One is called term, which will give us a term selector. So we can actually see which terms is available on this field, in this case the product name, in an analyzed version. And you can see how many occurrences we have from this one. So this will help you choose the right information from the index in here. So, and also if we go on things like the manufacturer, let's take a look at that one. Get a term selector. So instead of just showing the IDs, which is the ones that are indexed, we actually get the right words for it. And that was what I was trying to show you with the group ID, if I could find it, which I can't right now, but it's somewhere in the list. Instead of just showing the IDs, the term selector actually shows the right values from the database, making it much easier to set up what's going on. The other thing that we can do on this one, let's take a look at the updated data on this one to have a valid example. So now I have a date time, and I can now also add something called code providers. So, and these code providers are basically small add-ins that you can create yourself. These are configurable add-ins with some parameters on them, and I can say, give me all products that has an updated date that is equal to the date minus one day. So, today minus one day is a new way of making these more dynamic expressions. And like we do with macros that you know from the current implementation, these codes providers can return all kinds of dynamic data. And you can use some settings on top of these, and you can use those to make dynamic values on the expressions that you need to query somewhere from the user or whatever context you're looking at in the system. Then we also added some minor things like grouping the fields in these lists so they're easier to find and locate if you have large indexes and so on. And we go take a look at how we set up the facet. You now get a term count on the different values in this one, so I can see a short description. I get a term count of 1493, meaning that I would have a rather large facet, so it's probably a really bad idea to use this one as a facet. So that's some of the changes that we made on the index itself. So let's take a look at the next feature that we added on for 9.2, which is a product content management or a mini PIM that we will start we started developing and adding to the system. And this is something that you're going to see a lot of new development on during the spring. This is just the very first pre-release of the system, and it's meant to be a workflow-based product editing system, so you can set up a lot of logic on how should my product data be, and you get some queries and some indications on if your products are up to date, and you have an easy to use and configurable interface to edit all the data in it. The idea of this is of course to use it on top of your ERP system, because some of the data that we get out of the ERP is rather limited, and all the improvement of adding texts and images and categorizing the products is what this tool is meant for. So in some scenarios you are able to use Dynamicweb for all the enhancements of the product information instead of using a specific product information management system, and basically take out a bit of complexity of larger solutions. So what you do with this new mechanism is you define a number of searches and make a logic around some folders and these searches. So you can find all products with no image and handle those. It could also be finding all products that has an image and a description but that has not been published yet. And you can also find all products from a specific manufacturer that is lacking descriptions and so on. So you can set up all these searches, and if you put them together later on with a dashboard that you're going to see during the spring, you can define kind of a workflow and get an overview of your product data status in your database, and use that to ensure the quality of all the data is up to date and where you need to put in some effort to get the product information updated. So all these searches is the backbone of this new solution. On top of the searches, you have a new multi-product editor that makes it possible to edit your products in multiple languages, and you define which fields to edit in each of these searches, so they are very specific, specifically and targeted against the task that you're looking into. And you can also do things like categorizing the products and so on. And this is how it looks like. I'm going to show you in 1 second. how you can work with this. So let's go back into the administration and take a look at the e-commerce section, where you see a new product management node in here. And in this one, you can create folders and searches, basically. So I've created some simple folders with a couple of examples of how we can use this system. So I've created a search that says, give me a list of the recently updated products in my product catalog. Could be an interesting place to see what has been updated from the system. And underneath this search, we have the Smart Search Editor, which you partially know. It has received some new data, some new features for, compared to what you've seen. It's running on top of the index that we have created down here in the repositories, and you can control which index you to run on in this node. By default, you set it up to run on one of the indexes you have it in it. So the fields that we can search in are the same that we have on the index itself, but the user interface to define the actual search is much easier than using the index itself. So in this example, I've searching for all products that has an updated date after 1 week ago. And I can add, of course, all the rules that I want to, no new things under that. And one other new feature in the Smart Search is I get all the fields that is available on the products available here, and I can define which fields to show in the list, and I can also define which languages to show in the list. So when I run this query, I get the fields that I defined, and I can see the images, and I can see the translations of these. So this is a very important part of this system is I can query all the products and I can do translation, multiple translations directly in this one. I can also take another example, give me all products that doesn't have a SKU attached to it. I create a search that is looking for products that is active and where the product number is empty. And of course, the product number is important in this. I don't want to look at the price because it's not important in the context of this search. And maybe I only want to take a look at this in Danish and English instead of just running it on top of all my languages. So I basically don't have any products with any SKUs, so that's a bad one. There's another one here. These are queries that should be empty. I forgot I updated it. So this is querying all the products in my database where, let's wait for it, where all the products are active and where the price is set to less than one, or basically it's null. So this is a query I don't want to have because this means that I have a product on my website that is for sale for free. So of course this one should be, should not be, have any products in it. Another example is querying all the products that doesn't have any metadata. I've added the meta title to the search result. And let's take a look at the example of limiting what we see in the screen. So I only want the Danish and English, and I don't want to see the product number in this one. So now I get a very targeted a multi-editing screen that only targets updating the meta title. And you can see I can't edit the English text in this one, and that's because it has been locked in the settings down here. So title on the product is the same across language systems. And I have a question if the Smart Search can be set to bulk edit the variants instead of the languages. So you have variants down here. You will actually see if we find one product with variants. It has variants in this list. I'm just looking for one. I don't have any with no metadata, but you would get the variant. So if this product had a variant, it would be shown alongside this one. So you would have them stuck on top of each other, stacked on top of each other. And you can define on the Smart Search itself, if we take a look at it, if you want to say we have this, so let's see, where is it? Is Orion, I can set it to true or false. If I only want to search variants, or I set it to false if I only want to see the main product. So this is basically what defines whether or not to show variants in this in these views. As part of this, you can also see we now have product images in the backend, which is also a new feature you can set up on the product catalogs up here. So, and I'm now able to set up the image fold or the image patterns directly on the shop settings. And that means that we can now actually display images that are mapped automatically inside the administration. It also means that these information gets indexed, so we can use them in queries on the in the smart searches in here, so I can find products that doesn't have an image and so on. I can use it for that. So that's the early start of the product information management for Dynamicweb, and as I said, you're going to see a lot of new features in that one. So the future of this one, the first one is a dashboard you will get on the front page of e-commerce. And this PIM functionality will be moved into its own area in Dynamicweb. On this dashboard, you will be able to show queries and graphs and also some counters on the searches. And along with workflows on top of this, you can create scenarios where products go from one search to another search and so on in the journey to being published on the public website. You would also get a notification system, so if you have queries that should be empty, you can, if products show up in a query because of new products being imported, you would get an email saying you now have these products in your search, and the search should be empty, so you need to handle it somehow. You could also do it the opposite way. If a search go below 1,000 products, something is probably wrong and you should take a look at the product data in your system. So you can use it to make sure your data is valid and that bad things doesn't happen with your product data. You can also get the possibility of adding property, updating properties for the entire search. So instead of, if you search all the products in a specific group, and you want to update all the products with, for example, the same width or something like that, you can do it using the next version of this, and also adding new product category fields directly on the products is going to be a new feature, and eventually, not in within the next few months, but on a longer term, maybe 9.3. You're going to see some of the same feature of searching and editing data for users and the content tree as well. So you can search all users that you already have this. You can search all the users in the database that fulfill some criteria and edit them in bulk edit mode, and also set up some dashboards and workflows on your user database and do the same with the content database. Looking at some of the other things that has happened on e-commerce, recently in Denmark we had a lot of changes on how some of the credit cards are handled. All the Danish payment gateways has been updated and changed according to all of these new requirements. We've sent out some newsletters on this. There was a change on January 8th, and you're going to see one in 14 days from now, or 1 week from now. I think it's February 17th. The next update is coming. Taking a look at the technology part of this release, a deployment tool has been spoken for many years, and now we finally have an offering for you. And a deployment tool is made to support this journey of you have a development environment which usually sits on my own machine, and what this tool can do is all the things that you develop on your local machine all the settings you'd make to your solution, or the templates you create, or the item types you change and stuff like that, or if you set up a new delivery country, all that kind of changes to your system can be moved from your development environment and moved into a staging environment first, and then move it from staging to production. Or you could also basically skip production, staging if you want to. This deployment tool is provider-based, of course, so it has a source and a destination, these providers, and they can move from this first early version, they move data, meaning we can look at all the tables in the solution, and we can take data from those tables and move it to another solution. Another thing we can look at is the data schema. So if you added a new custom field to products, for example, we can take the data and the schema changes that are needed to move that change from your development environment up to your production environment. And then we can also look at settings. That means everything that relies in the or is placed in the global settings files, and things that you change on your in your management center configuring the solution. And the last thing this first version can move is files that would be templates and item type definition or index search and definitions and stuff like that. It can actually also move images, but there might be a there's definitely a limit on how much data it can move in one time. So if you move a folder of 150 megabyte images, it will probably not be a good idea. So it's meant to be moving files like templates and icons and item type definitions and indexes and stuff like that, smaller files. And these, the deployment tool is also based on configurations. So you basically configure a number of providers into a configuration that you put into your disk, into your file system, and you can create your own deployments for or your own configurations for your deployments on your own machine, targeted specifically at whatever you are working with. I'm going to show you one of these deployment files in a second. So what the deployment tool does, it collects a lot of changes you made on your system, and all that data is collected into files in the format of JSON, and all of these changes, each configuration group is put into one file, and all of them are put into a zip file, and that zip file is sent to the production solution where it's unzipped, and we take all the changes that the pack is containing and install them on the production environment. And what you can also do with these packs, if once we create the user interface for it, you can create a deployment pack and take the zip file and move it manually from one solution to another, or you can actually do a deployment from your local solution into a zip file, and that zip file can be deployed on new solutions, so you can use it to install templates or settings or configurations to your solutions if you have a new install base and so on. So it's kind of the same things that we can do with the packages. Let's take a look at the tool. The tool is in the management center in the backend, and is found in the developer section. We have a new Oh, wait, I think I have a permission problem, that's why. Just give me one second. So... sorry about that. So, in the developer section, there we got it, the deployment tool. I got all sweaty there. I have these deployment configurations, and we can see it as a big tree of deployments, and where I can go further down. So we have all the things related to e-commerce can come in one big image, or I can drill down to, for example, the e-commerce countries. And what I see here is some of the things I need to move for moving all the settings related to e-commerce countries that I find up here in internationalization. So it's basically all of this the data that is residing on this node called countries. And in this situation, it's actually moving the data from two different tables on the system, the table called ecom countries and the ecom country text. These definitions are some that we create. And in here, I can see what kind of some of the data that I'm going to move. So these are the names and the code from so this is a way to move all the records that we have on the database for this specific deployment pack. And if we take a look at how these are defined, so we have an XML file residing on in the file system of the solution, and we can see we have different providers. This is a data provider. We could also have the schema provider and the settings provider. And we basically define what kind of data that we should move. And these are basically what you see in the structure that we have right here. So let's take a look at this one. I have some countries in this solution. Denmark, Finland, Norway, Sweden, and so on. I can add some new countries to the list. I'll take Bahrain, because I definitely need to sell to that one. And right now I'm on my local solution, and I switch to my staking, which is happens to be local as well. And take a look at the, I think I have a database issue running on the same database. I have the country available already. What I want to show you is I can see that Bahrain shows up in this list, and I can basically just click the transfer selected. And what happens is deployment is gathering all the information, packing it all down and sending it away to the destination, which is my solution up here, where I get the data in already. But I also fucked up here, because this solution is apparently running on the same database. So that was kind of stupid. I'll make sure to show you this on a different database as well. One of the things that we set up on the deployment is the destinations. I can add as many destinations as I want to. So I just point to another solution, and I provide a login from the user management that has the administrative rights to put settings into to this solution. And we've defined a lot of these packs that we can take a look at moving a lot of the configuration that you can set up. So it can be all the order discounts that you set up on the solution, or it can be custom fields and order fields, and all that kind of things can be moved from this solution to another one. So clicking this one will find all the information that we have and move it to the remote system on this one. And you also have a log of all the changes that you, all the deployments that you have run on this solution. Here's another example of moving the item types, which is a file-based one. So we can see all the item types and all the settings that we have related to those can also be moved using this one. And we can combine these different providers into a configuration pack. So this is very first version. It lacks one obvious thing, is that you cannot compare your live solution, my development solution, with my production environment. So if we take a look at some of the features that we're going to add in the next month and two, is first of all the comparison between the solution I want to deploy to, so I can see what is the difference between my solution and the one I'm deploying to. And then we're going to see some new providers, a specifically targeted content provider that would be able to move pages and paragraphs, because this first version are not able to move pages because of the relationship. So if you try to do it, the page will be moved, but it will be located wrong in the navigation tree. So, and that's one thing that needs to be addressed, and we're going to do that in a specific content provider. And even though I just showed you moving item types, we're going to make a specific item type provider, so you can see which fields are changed compared to your production environment and only move the changes that you need. And I have a question if we can move item types not only from test to production but freely between solutions. And yes, you can do that. You can basically just create a destination in the deployment tool on your development machine and point it to any Dynamicweb 9.2 solution and above, and you can move the your item type definitions into that with the press of a button. So that's going to be a big help for also you can create a solution as a baseline and shoot configurations into solutions that are new or newly updated and so on. And you could basically create a deployment pack that contains this template folder and this item types and these settings from e-commerce countries and so on. So you can define some very nice packs of things you want to move, not only as a deployment, but also as configuration for new solutions. So that's nearing the end of this webinar. Packages, the package manager in the system. This one also found in here. It's now running against our MyGet feed that we have. Let me take a look. So, 1 second, other browser. The Dynamicweb packages. Whenever we release something, they are merged or moved into this feed, and we can see we released 9.2 on Tuesday. And today we released a package of 9.22. This morning we did that for because of a request from one of our partners. So we just pushed this one with a minor update to the API directly into this feed. We didn't make a release specifically for 9.22, but we released 9.22 of Dynamicweb DLL because it was just a minor update of the API. So now you're able to just update your reference using this feed in Visual Studio, or if you're on a specific solution like this one, I can go find the assembly in here and find the ones with the updates. I'm just gonna look for it. So let me see. I have version 1.11 installed and I have a 1.12. 1.12 available, and I can install that directly on my solution. And I'm able to define which feeds I'm looking at. You can also go into, this is the production feed. I'm also running on a local feed on this solution. I can also go and run against our development feed, which is where we add all the pre-release packages. So if you want to test out something that hasn't been fully released yet, you can go in and enable this one. So that's what we can do with the packages system. So let's switch on to last slide, which is the roadmap. Next major release is in August. The roadmap is not 100% complete, but this is the direction that we're taking. In the implementation side, we're going to work with how we work with content. So we're going to add a content builder for the paragraph lists, so you get a more what you see is what you get way of adding paragraphs and setting up the page. And that is also going to be released along with something called Rapido, which is a solution set or a predecessor to the RAP solution set for those of you who know use the set. And then we're also going to add some more view models, especially regarding the navigation to how you do implementation. On the functionality side, you're going to see a lot of the PIP system. We're going to add a lot of features to that specifically, and you're also going to see some releases during the spring containing the features as they get done. And you're also going to see dashboards, which is going to be an important part of the PIM solution as well. And we have some user experience things coming in on the marketing, especially around creating newsletters. We had a lot of wishes from new partners to make the process much more intuitive compared to what it is today. And of course, you're also going to see a lot of deployment tool. We have some things on e-commerce performance on large product lists and stuff like that we're looking into. And you're also going to see a lot of improvements to what the indexing and smart searches can do, also because it's an important part of the PIM solution. And still working on the integrations to NAVE especially, and also AEX. So we're going to spend more energy on that specifically. So that's it for today. Questions now, feel free to ask. Pierre Søgaard has a question about dashboards in new version. There's going to be a new version of the dashboards that is going to be configurable from all kinds, a large set of widgets, and you will be able to make your own widgets that can be added to the dashboard, showing everything from orders and statistics and deployment progress or searches from the PIM system or whatever you want to show in the dashboards. And we have a question if statistics is all gone. We collect statistics in Dynamicweb 9. We don't have a place to show it except some minor things on the front page. And it is actually also in the roadmap that we need a new user interface for reporting statistics in the solution.